started this morning. Thank you guys all for being here. I hope that each one of you were able to swipe in and that you got signed in for our big prizes today and at the end of the semester. As a reminder, we'll be giving away some smaller prizes today, but each time you come to a CareerWise Wednesday, you're entered in to our big drawing for a hand-tailored suit and a MacBook Air at the end of the semester. So keep coming. We've got a lot of great topics for the rest of the semester planned out. A couple of announcements before we get started. I wanted to bring to your attention a virtual event that we're having tomorrow, so Thursday evening, and it's posted on higherosugrads.com, but it's basically a virtual networking session. So you can do it from your smartphone, you can do it from a computer, but we've teamed up with the OSU Alumni Association to pair current students with alumni. So it's a simple chat room format. You'll have about 7 or 8 minutes paired with an individual, and then you basically are paired with someone else. So if you want to register for that, go to higherosugrads.com and click on the link for the virtual networking event, and it'll send you right to Brazen, and you can get signed up for that. Any questions? All right, without any further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker for today. Robert Robb is the coordinator for graduate studies in the College of Education here at Oklahoma State. Prior to joining the team here at OSU, Robert was the director of marketing and business development with SQL Data Systems. And prior to joining SQL Data Systems, Robert was with IBM for 27 years, where he worked in various sales and marketing roles, including systems engineering, strategic alliances, business development, and market management roles. Please help me in welcoming Robert.
Am I live? Am I on? Am I on? Can you all? Yeah. Oh, I can hear myself now. Wow. Well, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. As Kelsey said, I had 27 years of experience with IBM, so I say I'm a recovering IBMer. I'm now in academia, which is a lot different, a lot less stress. But all of you, when you're done with your education, are either going to continue on in academia or somewhere in the professional arena. And what I'm here to talk about today is how do you get started with that? How do you get going? And it's really all about your 30-second commercial, as I call it, your elevator pitch. Okay, so that's what we're going to talk about for the next 30 or 40 minutes. I'll have some exercises to do, and we'll continue from there. So feel free to stop me if you have any questions. Just raise your hand. I'd like to make this as interactive as possible. Okay? So the first thing I'm going to do is show you a quick little video here. Do with today's topic, right? It's a bunch of little kids, right? But they dream big. They all have different skills, whether you're the guy up there that's doing the welding, the person that's got the plans and doing the engineering. They've all got certain skills that they bring to the table. And each one of those kids or students brings something special to the table, right? That makes them unique. And together, look at the amazing things that they can do. This train gets to go loop to loop, and that's just a really awesome thing. So, hopefully, by the time you get to the end of this, you'll feel like you'll have some additional tools as well to do some awesome things when you go out into the workforce. So, what is this elevator pitch that I talk about, or your 30-second commercial? What is this all about, right? Well, it's really just a real brief message, about 30 seconds long, that's about you, something that's unique about you, that makes you special, in a way that you present this to the listener. Not, I'm the greatest thing ever, it's not bragging or boasting, but it's something that, a skill or something unique about yourself that you would have in a conversation with someone that you can bring to the table that would make that person more interested in learning more about you and you learning more about what they may have to offer in terms of opportunities. Okay, so again, it's a commercial about yourself. You want to do three things, right? Who you are, what you're looking for, and how you can benefit an organization, okay? Or a relationship. It may not be always when you're in an elevator talking to somebody about the next job or career, but maybe it's the next opportunity to get involved in something that you're passionate about that may lead you to the next career, and that's all about the whole networking piece of it. So it doesn't always have to be every time you're in an elevator, what's the next job or career fair, what's the next job, but what's the next opportunity for you holistically as a person. Again, it takes about 30 seconds, and they say that's about the time it takes to get from the bottom floor to the top floor, unless it's like, you know, 94 floors, and you got a little bit more time. But you want to keep it brief and concise, okay? At a career fair, which this will prepare you for, you can use that to introduce yourself. And if you practice your elevator pitch, then it becomes very natural for you. You'll have normal inflection, normal tone, instead of standing there saying things like this, like it, right? You don't want to come across like robotic with that, because that's very unnatural in terms of speaking. So what you want to do is make sure that you practice in front of a mirror, practice in front of groups of people, get feedback, and then that will help you improve and craft your messaging and make sure that your messaging is right on target, okay? Again, so make sure it's natural and comfortable for you. So what is this? What are the components of this commercial or 30-second speech, right? So it's about you and what you do. So like Kelsey could say, I could say things, and depending on the environment I'm in, it could be very professional where I used to tell people, I'm an engineer by degree and a marketeer by choice. Well, what does that mean? That could say a lot of different things to different people. To me, it says I have technical aptitude because I have an engineering degree. It happens to be electrical engineering. I worked for IBM for 27 years. Well, that doesn't really have a whole lot to do with electrical engineering, but it is a scientific discipline in terms of computer science. And the marketing piece is the piece that I'm passionate about. So I used to explain to people, I'm an engineer by degree and a marketeer by choice. And then I would take something that would be potentially very technical or abstract to the layman and explain it in layman's terms where they could understand it, and that helped me to be successful in my career. So that could be just who I am and what is it that I do. And that is very short and sweet, two sentences. I'm an engineer by degree and a marketeer by choice. Somebody could go, oh. If they ask questions, it's a lead-in for me to further explain that, right? I wouldn't use that. One of my passions is that I'm a non-professional chef and I like cooking and I like doing wine and food pairings. Well, if I happen to see somebody in a chef's coat standing in the elevator, I'm not going to tell them I'm an engineer by degree and marketeer by choice because it's not relevant, right? But that person may be involved in something in the food service business that I'm interested in. And again, this goes back to my example before. It's not always about the next job, but maybe the next opportunity. Hey, you're really great at desserts. I want to learn how to make whatever, right? So again, another opportunity for you to connect in terms of a network, and it's not always job related. Okay, what do you offer? What is your unique selling proposition, right? This is something that's unique about you, you as a person, and you can make that relevant to the conversation that you're going to have depending on who the listener is. Sometimes it's important that you say, I have a 4.0 grade point average. Well, if you're in a cast of a bunch of people where everybody that this recruiter sees has a 4.0, that doesn't really set you apart, right? So what is it maybe that you've done in terms of an internship or some other experience that you have that would set you apart? Okay, because then you could say, maybe to that particular listener, I have a 3.8 grade point average and I've interned with Marathon Oil for the last 3 years as a safety engineer or whatever the job happens to be. Then that person knows not only do you have the academic aptitude with your 3.8, but you also have skills and experience that you could bring to the table. Okay, so figure out for you what your unique selling proposition is. And then present it in a way that benefits the listener. So the person that you're speaking to, you could be an outstanding candidate, outstanding person, all this great stuff, but what does that mean to the person that's receiving that information, right? Again, I'll go back to my example. If you're talking to the chef in the elevator, my corporate experience isn't going to matter. That's not going to benefit that person, okay? But my experience going through, if it's somebody else that's a CEO of a company, and I have business processing re-engineering stuff where I've done actual activities working with how do you take something from good to great that make processes more efficient, that would resonate with the CEO of a corporation that says, oh, okay, I get this, this person could potentially assist me. Okay, and again, examples, how did you do it? What did you do? How did you do it? Okay, and that's where the skills and the experience comes in that may be outside the scope of, you know, how do you explain, well, how did you get your 4.0? That's not something you're really going to explain, but you can explain your field experience or other experience outside the classroom, okay? And then what's the call to action? This is the most important part that people tend to forget, because you could have an outstanding elevator pitch, 30-second speech. Now, this particularly wouldn't happen in an elevator, but if you're at the career fair and you're going and you're talking to different companies that are recruiting, what do you expect out of them, or what are you looking for? Is it a business card, right? Then ask, oh, I am interested more in your blah, 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 whatever that job is, your opportunities in engineering. Do you happen to have a business card? If they do, you know, they'll give you one, and if not, well, you know, they'll answer, I don't have one, whatever the case might be. Or whatever else you might be looking for. It may not be a business card. Would it be possible to contact you? Or could you have someone within your organization contact me? Here's my card. Whatever that call of action is, and depending on the conversation that you have, will determine what that call of action is. But you don't want to just leave it as in, here I am, this is what I do, it's a pleasure meeting you. What's that person going to do with that, or what are you going to do with them? What you want to try to do is continue that conversation, and what is the next step? Okay? So any questions on what that looks like in terms of kind of the structure? Good deal. So this is how do you do it? How do you build this 30-second elevator pitch or commercial for yourself, right? First thing is you have to identify or clarify your target. And what I mean by that is, for instance, if you happen to be in this audience and you are a finance major, and you're doing your introduction, I'm John Smith and I'm a finance major at Oklahoma State University, blah, 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 right? Well, what does that really mean to the person that's hearing that, right? Because your passion, even though your curriculum might be in finance, it may be that your passion is more in financial instruments or banking, or you're looking to be a CPA, right? That's all financial, but it doesn't leave it clear to the person that's receiving the information. Well, what is it that motivates you? Where do you want to make an impact, right? And how that person may or may not be able to assist you, depending on what that is. So if you don't have one, you first have to identify it. And if you do have one, you want to make sure that you make it as clear as possible, okay? And that might change depending on who you're talking to, or you may not have actually decided. So depending on who the person is, if you're talking to a group that is, you know, tax consultants and CPAs, you might craft your elevator pitch toward that, where if you're talking to somebody else that's in the banking industry, again, you could craft it in that direction. Maybe you're looking at crossing those so you get experience in both arenas and still stay in the financial sector. Okay, this is the hard part. Step number two, write down everything that comes to your mind. And try to leave an open mind about the things that motivate you and things that you're passionate about, things, reasons that you get up and you're energized in the morning, right? Just write them down. Take a ledger pad, write it down, right? You'll see after you do that, after you take that little exercise, some common themes in there. You'll see stuff that's like, you'll question, does this even matter, right? But after you get to write it all down, then you get to take your red pen and start crossing stuff out. cross out the things that don't matter, things that are, would be irrelevant in a conversation, right? Sometimes they are and sometimes they aren't. If you're really an outdoors person, right, and that's really something that you is important to you, that being inside, my daughter's that way, she's an artist, but she hates being inside, right? So it's kind of complicated when you start going to that, but it's important to her to be outside, so she needs to work in an environment where she can be outside as much as possible. So sometimes when you think it's not important, when it is core to you and it is important, then you need to make sure that you do include it, okay? So cut the jargon, acronyms, and oh, trust me, when I worked in IBM, I also worked in telco, the two biggest companies that have acronyms like nothing you've ever seen, right? Cut them out, because they won't mean anything to anybody unless that person is in that specific industry and understands it. So you want to be very clear to cut out the acronyms, the jargon, right? And make short, powerful sentences. And I'll have an example here in just a minute. Connect the phrases to each other. So, because you don't want to talk about one thing over here and then talk about something over here and then something up here. You know, you want to make sure that it flows, it makes sense, and that it's clear and concise to the listener. So, anyone, and if you could just go up to any stranger on the street and say your 30-second elevator pitch and they would understand it, you will know that you've hit the mark, okay? Again, memorize your key points and practice, practice, practice. Again, practice it in your head, practice it in front of a mirror, practice it in front of a group. Even if you write it down, sometimes I do this, I'll craft a letter to somebody and I'll say, I know it's in my head, but I also think a lot. I have all the background information and a lot of stuff that I process as I write this letter. Give it to somebody else and have them read it. Does it make sense, right? Can I say this in a better way that's more clear? You can do the same thing with your elevator pitch. Give it to a friend and say, does this make sense to you? What? You know, or, oh yeah, oh, I didn't know that. Yeah. So you can start the dialogue and it'll help improve it. Okay? Three things you want to make sure that you always answer in your elevator pitch. Who are you? Right? What do you do? And what are you looking for? Those are the three elements that you need to make sure that are included in the elevator pitch, okay? And then I'll go back to create different versions for different business situations, and I'll use the example before. It could be a CPA versus somebody in banking. So you might craft it. Some of the core elements will still be it. Obviously, who you are isn't going to change, right? What you do, you might craft the experience that you've done. I worked in retail banking for 2 years as an intern, right? If you're talking to the banking person, you may or may not bring that over if you're gonna do the CPA side just to show that you had experience. If that's the only experience you have and you wanna show that you've gained some experience and skill, then clearly include it. But if you've got different skills, that may not be the same skill you wanna take over, okay? Any questions? Because we're gonna do this as an exercise. So I want all of you, and I'll just give you just a few minutes to do it, just write down a target, and then just take a few minutes, and this doesn't have to be everything you can think of, but just take everything you can think of and write it down. I'll give you a couple minutes to do that, and we'll see if we can come up with, if somebody can come up with, a really quick elevator pitch. Okay, any questions on that? I'll put an example up on the board if you want to read that to get an idea, but I'll give you a couple more minutes just to write one for yourself. Sorry for all the noise. Anybody want to volunteer with their statement? Go ahead.
Okay, all of it?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry, can I finish writing this one before?
Yeah.
Perfect. So my elevator pitch is, good afternoon, my name is Carson Gwynn. I'm a senior economics and finance major with a minor in accounting. I'm very interested in pursuing a career in the energy industry, specifically your position in your commercial supply and trading organization. I've had two prior internships in the energy industry, one of which I worked on a crude oil buyback option contract where, when implemented, it gained the company about $600,000 annually, and I would love to apply the skills and knowledge that I gained in these prior internships to your company.
Okay, she's not a plant, okay, just for the record. Okay, she honestly did volunteer. That was excellent.
Thank you.
So, that was excellent. Anybody else? Okay, that's a great example. You may want to, and I'll read my example and I'll show you what I've done with this example to kind of craft it. I'm gonna see if I can move this. Oh, sorry for the feedback. Who knows? So I would say it's an excellent statement. You just want to make sure, and of course you're on the spot, 30 seconds, let's go, right? But if you practice that, it'll flow real nicely and you'll be able to hone that down to where it's really quick and concise. And that's what you want to work towards. And that was a great job. Anybody else want to give a go at it? Come on, we gotta have another volunteer. No? All right, well, we'll move on. So here, I just did an example. Oh yeah, go ahead.
Okay, good afternoon, Mr. Rao. My name is Sid Suresh. I love working with people and more so with technology, and because of that, I'm currently pursuing a degree in telecommunication management. I have more than 3 years of work experience in systems administration and access management. I understand your company is currently looking for a systems engineer, and I would love to talk more about that with you.
Okay. Good example. Good example. What I would caution you on is, it's great that you like to work with people, but what do you mean? Okay? So just if you're going to use, and you can be vague in your statements, but you just, that's where the experience piece, if you say, I like working with people, and what is it about people that you like? Right? Or why is it? There are those people that like, get me in front of a tube, I like to do data analysis, all you people go away, right? There's other people, if I don't have a team, I can't work, right? So it just depends on where you fall on that spectrum in terms of what you're comfortable with. So I would just advise you, if you do like, and I'm one of those people that likes working with people, right? So I can understand that, but explain why or elaborate on that. But good example, thank you for sharing. Okay, so here's the example I did. This was just a kind of a dummy example. And I'm gonna go through this and I'll read this or you can read it, whatever. But I'll show you, I tweaked it just a little bit. And this is just for the point of having the exercise in that you can take something, if you come up with your first statement, it's okay to figure out how can I make this better? How can I improve on this? And what differences can I make, right? And I'll explain the nuances in this app when I go to the second example. So it says, hi, I'm Alex Smith. I'm currently a senior and I'm studying computer and information science. I hope to become a computer programmer when I graduate. I had a couple of internships where I worked on several program applications with a project team. I enjoy developing computer applications for simple business solutions. The position you have listed in the IBM job link seems like it would be a perfect fit for someone with my skills. I'd like to hear more about the type of project teams in your organization. Well, so a couple of things with this with me is what skills do you speak of, right? It's not real clear. Perfect with my skills. Well, exactly what are those, right? So there's some things in this. This is a good statement, but again, it's all about going from good to great. And so what I've done is I've done an example here where you see, of course, it's a little bit shorter, so it definitely will fit in within the 30 seconds. Hi, I'm Alex Smith. Again, who you are, that part does not change, right? I'm currently a senior and studying computer and information science. Okay, I had a couple of internships where I worked as part of a team on several program applications to solve HR and payroll business challenges. So the nuance in this is, I work with a team. I like working with other people. I do well with other people, right? So it shows I've built the skills as an intern, worked as part of a team, you've done program applications, this is the specific area which you've done, and you've solved business problems. That's the impact that you've had. So if we go back, we can take a look at that, and you can see I've had a couple of internships where I worked on several programs. Well, is it the program or the team? And that's the nuance of where that might make a difference, right? But it doesn't tell you what kind of business solutions, and again, it doesn't tell you what kind of skills. Where in this case, it does, right? I believe the position you have listed in IBM JobLink will allow me to leverage and build my skills. So taking what I've already learned, right, because I've already done this in my internship, and then I want to build upon it. That is the business value or the benefit to the listener. Because they're going to make an investment in you as an employee, and they want some sort of return on that investment. And that's the message that you send, again, in the nuance in the language. Can you tell me more about the type of project teams in your organization? Right, that person may not be able to tell you that. They're just the HR recruiter. They don't work with those project teams, but the call to action, as we talked to you before, they could say, no, I'm sorry, I can't talk to you about that. Is there someone who can? Or who within your organization can I contact? Getting to your call of action. Great, it's Kelsey Lee. Great, here's her phone number. In fact, her cell phone number is. So anyway, again, just a little bit of the nuance there in terms of what you say, how you say it, and the presentation that you want to make of yourself. In terms of what is the impact that you can have and what is the business value in terms of what you bring to the table for the listener, specifically in terms of a recruitment fair, not necessarily in the elevator. Any questions? Now that everyone's seen the two different examples, anybody want to try it now? Feel more comfortable? Are you on the right path? Heads yes, heads no. Thumbs up, thumbs down.
We have two more people practice. This is the best place to practice it. Yeah. You've got great listeners, and it'll help you prepare for the career fair that is coming up.
During this time, do you take breaks that have, like, the employer to respond to you at all, or do you just have, like, a statement, like,
Well, this is why it's important. It's a great question, and thank you for asking that. This is why it's important to practice. Because again, you're not going to stand there like with your little cue card, "Hi, I'm Alex Smith," and that's not going to work for you, right? So you could just say, "Hi, I'm Robert Robbins, pleasure to meet you," and then continue on with whatever. That's why it's important to memorize this. And you know what? If you memorize it and you put, you know, like, you start off with, you know, I'm a computer and information science person, and you start with the whole, "I've worked on some project teams," and then you realize, oh, as an intern, that's okay, right? You don't have to, "Oh, I screwed it up. I should have told him I was an intern before I worked on." That's not what's critical. What's critical is really the elements and then how you put those elements together. And again, so it all flows and that all of these elements are somehow connected that benefit you and benefit the listener. So that's a great question. So yeah, you'll have, because they may ask you, for instance, if this was the person that, this was that the conversation you had, they could say, "Oh, how long did it take you to write that application?" "Oh, 2 weeks. "Oh, wow, really? Oh, 16 months. "Oh, what happened?" Right? You don't know what that kind of response is going to be. You don't even know that that's the question they're going to ask. But they could theoretically ask that question, and then that gives you the opportunity then also to explain more. "Yes, it was a team of 6 people. It took us 6 weeks, and when we were done at the end of that, we had a 92% success rate on implementation, and it saved, you know, Acme payroll $30,000 in the first month." That, to a CEO or recruiting person, is going to resonate because it's all about the business value, right? Sometimes you can't cite those specific numbers. If you can, and it's applicable and relevant without taking a lot of time, sure. But you don't need to in order to get your message across as well. It's the follow-up questions that gives you the opportunity to do that. Another question?
I got one.
Yeah.
It's kind of like nitpicky, but does it matter if you say your last name or not? Like, does that, normally when the recruiter introduces himself, they're like, "Well, hi, I'm Alan." Like, there's not, they don't also say their last name. Does that matter?
The recruiter or you?
No, like, you introduce yourself, like, "Hi, I'm Ben." But when they reciprocate, they normally also just say their first name. So do you just need to say your first name, or do you say your first name?
I would advise you to use your first and last name, because although there are multiple John Smiths, there's going to be a lot more Johns than there are, you know, like for me, Robert Roth, that's a pretty unique name, right? And as a child, I'll admit, as a child, I got teased for that, you know, first name's the same as your last name, like, but professionally, it became an advantage for me because I could use it as an icebreaker. "I'm Rob Square," or "I'm Rob Rob, no, I don't stutter," you know, different things like that. That makes it memorable, and memorable matters, right? If you just come in, "Oh, hi, I'm Ben." Ben who, right? Or, "Crap, I saw 3 Bens today. I don't know which Ben that was," right? So if it's, you know, I don't even know what your last name is, but you know, if it's Ben Swanson, I'm gonna know versus just Ben. So I would say, even if your recruiter says, like, if I were to say, "Hi, good afternoon, I'm Robert, nice to meet you," it would be informal, and you could say, "Hi, it's nice to meet you as well, Robert. My name is Ben," because we're now on a first name basis, but I would advise you to use first and last name. I think it's important. Any other questions? Okay, we'll continue on. So I did this part already, volunteer, pick me, but so is there anybody else then that wants to volunteer or practice an opportunity or having trouble kind of putting your sentences or thoughts together?
What if you don't have any internship experience? What if you're going there? Okay, my previous degree and where I worked has nothing to do with what I'm doing now, the degree I'm seeking, and what I'd like to do. So my previous experience in hospital work is kind of irrelevant.
Okay, so there's 2 things on that I would encourage you to do. Number one, kind of, no matter what it is that you've done in the past, and it may be a challenge, I'm not gonna say that it's easy, but figure out what it is that you've done in the past that you can link to what you want to do in the future, okay? I worked at IBM, I have a lot of corporate experience, it's all been in, and I'm in academia now, right? That's a huge change. And as a matter of fact, when I applied for jobs at the university, I specifically wrote in my cover letters that my move into academia was intentional. It's not like, well, what are we gonna do with this guy that makes hundreds of thousands of dollars, worked in the corporate world, and then he's gonna come to academia working on a state salary and go, I'm bored, right? Because to a recruiting person, that could be a real possibility. It was my passion for education and the next generation, which is what got me here. So I made sure I articulated those things into what I wanted to do. So two things, relate something in your past that's driving you to your future, and you can do that. And number two, leverage your passion, because that's gonna come through anyway, right? If you're passionate about it, those people are gonna understand that like right away. I explained earlier, my daughter's an artist, right? I say, I can't even draw a stick figure. I really can't, right? I couldn't bluff my way through an interview to be an artist if my life depended on it. It's just not me. Other things I'm super passionate about, and you're gonna know when I get talking, I'll talk fast, I can articulate. You can just see the energy come across. That's important. Recruiters will see that and they'll understand that, right? Now again, if you come across as a like, I'm Joe of the party and it's gonna be a great time, and you're working in an office full of data processing analysts, that's probably not the right fit for you, right? So again, I just caution you, but when you talk to a recruiter, look at those two things. And so your background, you said, was healthcare, and what are your, and you have a former degree in that area, and what are you moving toward now?
Management Information Systems.
Okay. Yeah, I'd have to think about how that would apply. Did you do patient care?
I work in the laboratory.
Okay.
I analyze blood and anything else that's inside the body, and I want nothing to do with it now. I mean, mm-hmm. My decision.
But was it all manual, or was it also processed through data processing?
Most of it was manual. You know, there was a microscope, and you know, yes, I had to speak with doctors and put information into computers and explain what those results meant.
But that's what I'm saying. That's how you could look at that and say, or your background, you could explain that's what's driven you to this. I worked in an industry that was so archaic that everything was done on three-copy paper, right? Carbon paper, which was extremely inefficient. And what I'm looking to do is increase efficiencies by leveraging technology such as computers, okay? So there's an example of where you can take what your history is and turn that, it's like, oh God, it sucked, I hated it all, I don't ever want to do it again. You're taking that negative thing and turning it into a positive that you can leverage in your favor, right? So that is one of the things that is a unique selling proposition. Now, think of it this way, let's take it even grander. What if that interview is with a pharmaceutical company or a medical devices company or something in the medical field? Oh, let me tell you, I've worked in your industry, and let me tell you, I've got the solution for you. That's your unique selling proposition that probably nobody else in this room has. So you don't have to look at that as something that's being your negative, but that's your unique selling proposition of something that you can bring to the table, okay? So that's a good example. And that goes for all of you. We all, if we stop and think about what our past is, you really can. And you know, that took us all of about 3 minutes to take something like, oh my God, how do I do this, to, oh, I got this, right? So there's a good example. And you can all do that same exercise. It just takes a little bit of work in your head. Talk to some colleagues. If anybody wants to come see me, I'll work with you on that. but you can make it believable. So, this comes kind of, we'll wrap it up here. In conclusion, first impressions matter. So this is why it's important to practice, polish your speech, be positive. They're gonna know, they're gonna take note. Say your first and last name, those things are gonna matter. Again, sell who you are, what's your impact, and what sets you apart from the competition? What makes you unique? What's that unique selling proposition of yourself? And then what are you seeking? What do you wanna do? Why you're the best fit? Because it's not about you, like, oh, I'm a great person. No, it is. We're all great people, right? But what is it about you that makes you the best fit for that particular organization, that job, that opportunity, right? Because that's what you want to sell. And then what is your desired outcome? Again, this is that call to action piece. What do you want? Do you want to just build a relationship with that person because you want a mentor relationship? You know, depending on what the situation is in the elevator. Is this some type of networking thing? Is it a professional connection? Is it a personal connection? Is it a job opportunity? Is it an opportunity? I mean, your elevator pitch could even be working on, like, you know, I always played baseball in Little League and I haven't done it for 15 years and I want to get back into it, right? Is that person in there, is that person that have the capacity to help you achieve whatever it is, that next opportunity for you, not just a job opportunity? So what's the desired outcome? What do you want? You want to get their contact information? Do you want a business card? Do you want an opportunity to interview? What is it that you want? What's your desired outcome? Okay? Excuse me. And this is just a little video. So what do you think their elevator pitch was?
Why do you have my room key?
Yeah, the whole point of that was, I happen to love that ad. I think it's kind of hysterical. But also, just the point being that it was very timely in that there is an elevator, and those two are meeting for the first time on the elevator. And of course, this is not the elevator pitch we're talking about today. But it's, you never know who you're gonna meet on the elevator at any time and what you're gonna say. You know, you can stand there and look at the numbers or you can have the conversation. And if you know that that person is somebody that you're interested in having that connection with, then it's best to be prepared. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. I thought it was a little bit of fun, but anyway, thank you for having me. If you have any other questions, I'll take them now. Yeah.
I was wondering, so when they're going over resumes, there's always this push for applying, you know, numbers, apply any quantitative backing that you have for the things you've worked on. Do you think that's something that should apply in your elevator pitch as well, or is that something that you should wait to bring up until later on in your conversation?
That's going to be one, I hate to answer that, it depends. Typically, it's not required, and I think it's safe if you don't have them. I would say that I would be more general in my elevator pitch and then get the specific numbers as questions come out, okay? Unless it's something that you can say that you've done over and over and over again. Like, if you say, I'm very much, hi, my name is Robert Robin. I'm majoring in marketing at Oklahoma State University. I've worked on a lot of campaigns, both traditional marketing and internet marketing. And of all the internet marketing campaigns I've done, I've increased the response rate by, on average, I've increased the average response rate by 42%. That's one number, right? It's, and it shows how much you've moved the needle. Now, if it's, I've increased it by 3%, you probably won't want to say that, right? If you say it's 82%, that's pretty stunning. And then the person could say, well, how did you do that? Well, I utilized these tools, or I utilized these techniques, and then you can talk about that. Or if you, if in my example, I said it was 42%, you could say that was my average. Some of them were 35, most of them were 82, or whatever, right? Then you can have additional dialogue on numbers and specifics. But I would tend to not put them in your elevator pitch, because depending on what that is, it's more likely to or not to be relevant to the listener. And so the more vague, if you will, that you make your elevator pitch, the more it will resonate with anyone, okay? But like I said in my example, if I say 42%, we all understand where 42% is between 0 and 100, okay? Did that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Any more questions?
I didn't have any texted in today, but I would like, and I'm gonna pick somebody if nobody will volunteer, maybe someone that has not had an internship or a lot of experience, so if there's a freshman or sophomore in the room, to volunteer to see what you've got written down right now, and let's have Robert and team craft an elevator pitch for you, because we had two really strong examples, but maybe if you don't have any experience and are wanting to prepare for the career fair, let's do an example there. Anybody want to volunteer?
Or like we did with the healthcare. I mean, that was a great example. I feel like you were struggling, like, oh, what do I do with this? How do I craft this into something that I could use as a selling point? Because really, at the end of the day, it's all about your selling point is the impact that you can make on the job opportunity or the employer that you're having this conversation with.
I would volunteer if somebody else is going to take the opportunity.
Okay, so I'll do it. Okay, so what all I have is I'm Mary Kirkhoff, and I'd like to get an internship in information assurance, and that I used to work in healthcare. I worked in healthcare for 10 years.
Okay, so that's a great start.
Okay.
And so how I would assist you with that is, and then lay it out logically, that would say, hi, I'm Mary, right? And I, so you say who you are and what you do. So hi, I'm Mary, majoring in computer information systems or whatever your specific title is at Oklahoma State University. Before coming to Oklahoma State University, I worked for 10 years in the healthcare industry and gained a lot of experience in terms of whatever that experience is, right? And I'm currently looking for opportunities to leverage my skills for an internship in the blah, 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 right? So the only thing I would say, based on the way that it was presented to me right now in the example, is you did your ask at the beginning, which was, I'm looking for an internship, which is great. Let's get right to it. Let's cut out the stuff, right? But you haven't given the listener enough information of, an internship and what? And what do you want to do? And why should I pick you? And what is your experience? And so they need some of that background information to understand, oh, okay, now I get it. And you want an internship in X. So that's how I would go about tracking that. Somebody else? I'm free. So, you know, you leverage.
Anybody else? Mary, do you want Sonic or Aspen gift card?
Sonic.
Okay. All right, we've got
a here we go. You're a freshman, okay?
So what I have is I worked two wheel jobs in high school, but then I was also a soccer referee for a while. But I worked at a grocery store as a cashier for 2 years, and before that I worked at a Legend Senior Living. It's an assisted living care.
Okay.
5 months, so it's just like from May to October.
Uh-huh.
But that's all. And then I was a referee before that for a couple of years. So
Okay, so first of all, what's your name?
Jaden.
Jaden? Okay, I'm Robert. And what's your major?
Finance with a minor in Spanish and entrepreneurship.
He is a plant. I'm not gonna work with this. Okay. Finance, minor in Spanish. Okay, and what are you passionate about?
Helping people.
Okay. In what way? I'm gonna go back to the same example. In what way?
I looked at assisted living place for a while. So what I did there was I worked in the dining area. So like I would take residents' orders. I would serve them food and then like pretty much get like whatever else they needed. I would clean up afterwards.
Okay, and so you said finance and entrepreneurship, right?
Finance with minor entrepreneurship in Spanish.
In Spanish, okay. Why the Spanish?
Well, my last name is Spanish, and my dad's side of the family speaks Spanish, so like, I want to be able to communicate with them better in a better way, but also it makes me more marketable in a workplace.
Yeah.
Especially like, I love like the West, so like, I thought about, moving like to out West someday, there's a lot of Spanish people there, so I thought it would just make me more marketable. And plus,
it will.
I just want to know the language.
Okay. I'm just asking, and I'm not really trying to pry or anything like that, but I'm trying to formulate in my head, okay, who are you and what makes you unique? So you can say, hi, my name is, and I'm, my major is finance with a minor in Spanish and entrepreneurship, right? So you've laid out the credentials of who you are. Now the part is what makes you unique, right? You could take your experience and you could say, I'm looking for opportunities where I can assist people achieve their goals, okay? Now, that's very generic. That could be any person in here. It could be Kelsey as a person, or that could be translated to a business. How does the business achieve their goal, right? Because that's important to anyone in business in terms of their bottom line. How much money they're gonna make, how much are they gonna spend, what is the impact or outcome that they're looking for, right? So you can explain that part of it that says, you're trying to help people or help businesses, people and businesses, however you want to explain that, achieve their goals. I've done that in the past by working with individuals and teams as a coach, right? So now you've taken some of your skills and you've applied that, not toward specifically the coaching field, right? But toward how can I take those tangible skills where I'm helping groups of people achieve their goals and sell that in a way that it is understandable to a potential recruiter, okay? That's how I would approach that. So even though you might have some disjointed jobs in the past, you still bring skills to the table, and then those are the skills you want to leverage or present of yourself as you go forward. Is that helpful? So, and I would also encourage you, maybe you say, I'm looking for international opportunities, right? Now, maybe you want to stay in the United States, and that's not the right thing to say. Only you can determine that, right? But I've done international business all over the world, and it is, to me, it's very exciting. I like to travel. It's very exciting. Different cultures are very exciting to me. I loved it. Other people, it's not their thing. I don't understand the language. I'm not going. It's a personal thing. But for you, if you're in an opportunity where you want to work for a multinational company, it's great. Because now that, again, that's something that's going to set you apart. Not only can I tell you this in English, I can tell it to you in Spanish. Or I've done the same thing where it's like you do international business, it helps if you know the language, where I could take technical things and explain them in layman's terms as an engineer and a marketeer. You can do it as someone that understands English and Spanish, and that you can leverage that very much so. So don't be afraid. That's the thing. That's the other thing I want to challenge all of you. Don't be afraid to think about. That's why you write down all of these things. And you think, oh my God, I've done Spanish for 4 years. Who cares? Somebody cares. So think about the things and think about the audience and articulate those things that matter.
Anybody else? Okay, I'm gonna have Robert draw. one name for me. I'm redrawing everybody else.
I don't get to draw 16.
No. Ben, you want a teacher? I put you in.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Okay, I also have t-shirts for Emily, Newbie, Joey Hector?
Hilker,
sorry. Chris Day, and Isaac Wilson. So come on down, Kelly's got t-shirts for you guys. If they're not the right size or the color that you want, you can follow us over to 103 and we'll switch them out. But let's give Robert a thank you.
Thank you. Again, if anybody, Kelsey has my contact information. I know you know how to get a hold of her, or if you want to get a hold of me, I'm over in Willard 102A. Like, oh my God, you said 103. I'm like, I'm not in 103. 102A over in Willard. Come see me. I'll be happy to work with you one-on-one. If you've already got your statement, I'll help you craft it. If you don't have anything, like, oh my God, I'm so lost, I'll help you get started. Be more than happy to do that.
So. Thank you. We'll hopefully see you all next week for our next topic, and watch social media on Monday to see what that topic is going to be. If you didn't get signed in, I think everybody did, but make sure you got your name in for the drawing for the suit.